Parashat Matot, Book of Bamidbar, Book of Numbers, Chapter 30, will be some type of introduction for today, sugya, for today, daf. I'm just reading word by word in the Torah, Vedaber Moshe L'Rashe HaMatot, Moses spoke to the heads of the tribes, Livnei Yisrael, L'mor, Zeh HaDavar Shel Tziva Hashem, Ish Ki Yidor Neder. Here they speak about a person that take a vow, he pronouncing a sort of vow or oath. So here the passage is giving a very clear power to a person to invoke a vow or oath and he commit himself to a certain act. The Torah goes further to speak about married women. And they said in, again, chapter 30, book of Numbers, verse 7, Vim hayot tiye leish, if the woman get married to a man, that's kiddushin, the first step of marriage, Rashi said. So it's basically is no equivalent to really the English language, but the idea is they betrothed, even though they are not yet living together, until after the second phrase, which is the marriage ceremony. It's called Nisuin. The woman is legally bound to her future husband, and he's liable to the all the involvement with the committed relationship. So then they said, Undarea alea, and her vows were upon her, which you make a vow before a marriage. So then it's a part, Omiv Tasfa de Aaron Aton on her lip, Asher Asra Nafsha, that she prohibited upon herself. Veshama Isha Biyom Shomo, when the husband heard on the day of his hearing, Vecherishla, and he was silent about her, and therefore, Vekamu Nedarea, Vesarea Asher Asra Nafsha Kumo. And her vow shall stand, and her prohibitions established upon herself shall stand. But if on the day that her husband hearing, I'm just translating the text, he shall restrain her, and he shall revoke the vow that is upon her, or the utterance on her lips, by which she has prohibited something upon herself, then Hashem will forgive her. So here you see the difference between the husband played the Fifth Amendment, right? Remain silent. If he was acquiesce, then it's taking an effect. Versus the husband can do a type annulment. Here you see a difference between annulment and revocation. But the idea is he has the right, he has the access. So here we are dealing with a painful situation, which is a conflict between husband and wife, and while there is a conflict, he commit himself, for example, not to have relation with her. And the question we presented yesterday, if it was time restrained, if it was restricted for a certain time, how far we, meaning the rabbis, the rabbinic court, how far we hold to enforce a party to depart from the other. For example, it's a disputation among the Rishonim, we explained yesterday. If it's a regular Yisrael, if it's a regular fellow, so we can go and force him, some said, to divorce her. Some said, no. But the issue we explained yesterday, when it's a Kohen, the moment he divorced his wife, if he regretted, he cannot bring her back to him. So therefore, we explained yesterday, following the Mishna, that up to the period of 30 days, he doesn't need to divorce her, but more than that, then he needs to divorce her. So since we go to that framework, we went also yesterday to the issue of someone who said to his wife, I not allow you to, or he prohibited to touch any anything related to his wealth. For example, something that she used to make a living toward that, and he put a restriction that she cannot touch it, which unfortunately it happens, right? So Rabbi Yehuda Omer, here we are on page 71, top of the page. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Bisrael Chodesh Echad, which means up to 1 month, if it's a non-Kohen. So 1 month, he can follow that commitment. But then, he needs to release, he needs to let go. And they said, Hainu Tanakama, which means the idea of him taking a steward for 1 month, it's matched the view of the first Tana, that he's also said that up to 30 days, it should use a steward. So what is the real disputation between Rabbi Yehuda and Tanakama, the first one? Amar Rabbaye Kohenet Atala Shmu'inan. Rabbaye said that Rabbi Yehuda meant to teach us the rule of a wife of Kohen, that she can survive or she can be sustained by a steward for a period of 2 months. So it means that Tana Kama, the first sage, hold that there is no differentiation between the wife of a regular non-Kohen to a wife of a Kohen. And he said that he never used a steward only the period of up to 30 days. Rabbeinu Chasdai ibn Karkash, it's a great rabbi of the 12th century, he asked a question, if Tana Kama differentiate between the wife of Kohen or not, because he used the word of Abaye, Kohenet Atala Shmu'inam. Why he used that term? He doesn't say Kohenet Ika Benaihu. So Rabbi Yehuda, however, disputed him, and he said, when it's come to wife of Kohen, it can be up to 60 days, 2 months, but if it's a regular Israel, is no difference between Rabbi Yehuda and the first Tana. Now, Rava Amar Chodesh Male veChodesh Chaser Ika Benayu. Tosfot elaborates on that. Chodesh Male, meaning 30 days period, which is full months. Chaser, missing, is 29 days. Rabbi Yehuda meant, when he used the term Chodesh, month, to 29 days. In general, Tosfot here explain, whenever they use the term Chodesh, we explained at the introduction of Tractate Rosh Hashanah, what does that mean? How far you go? So it means the difference between Rabbi Yehuda and Tanakama. Tanakama hold 30 days. But that's full. Rabbi Yehuda hold that is 29 days only. So if someone prohibit his wife up to from deriving any benefit up to 30 days, we said in the Mishnah that he need the amit parnas. He need to put a steward, like a guard, or someone who distributed toward her. Amarav lo shanu ela bemefaresh. We are speaking about someone who said unequivocally, lucidly, he said that it's that period of time. He said specifically that he prohibited her to derive benefit from him up to what? Up to 30 days. Aval bistam. But, however, if he is not specified a time restraint for his vow commitment, yotzi le'altar v'yiten ketuba. So he needs right away to depart from her and pay the marriage contract. And you do not wait a period of 30 days by having a steward, because that prohibition will carry on even the passing of 30 days, And since he is not restricted the time of the vow, we assume that the time where Rashba said is during the period of 30 days, he intend to change, to release that vow. So therefore, he can go by retroactive act and immediately release her. Ushmuel Amar, and Shmuel said, Afilu bestam lo yotzi, even a case where the vow was for unspecified term, he doesn't need to divorce her immediately, but he support her by means of stud for 30 days. Why? Shema yimatze petach lenidro. As we explained earlier, when someone made a vow, so he come before the rabbis, and he tried to find a way, a gate, a room, a hole, that he can get out of that commitment. For example, God forbid, someone at the middle of the night, he's driving a car, he hit a curve, the car is upside down, and the car is smoking, God forbid. So the person make a commitment. If I survive, I will do so and so. Okay? If he wake up in a hospital and he survive, so we cannot let him out of that commitment. But to trace a situation that he commit himself to give such amount of money that it's totally above his capacity. So one of the things we ask a person is, if you know at the time of the commitment that that's going to be the result, do you make that commitment? So the key idea is, if you have either yachid mumche, an expert, erudite, sage, or shlosha yedotot, or three rabbis that just sit and listen to him, and they find a petach, they find some room, some hole, that go and say that if I knew in my heart of hearts when I made that commitment that that's it's all about, I'll never do that. So therefore it's a mistake. Now we must know that it's a differentiation between when is a petach, when is not. If the guy said, I'm going to close my store on Shabbat and I'm going to come to shul every Shabbat, right? So guess what? No Bedin can release him from that vow, even he losing a lot of money by closing his store. You agree with me? However, if it's, for example, as we said earlier, if it's a huge financial commitment, or if it's something that it's way above his normal capacity, so the big disputation among the rabbis, the Amoraim, if is any room to let him out of that commitment, meaning if he totally regret it, yet if you cannot find a room to let him out, if is any way to let him out of that commitment or not. We studied, if you remember, in Tractate Ruvin, page 64b, and is also on Tractate Nedarim, pages 21 and 77. So here you see, if you find a room to open it, so during the 30 days, he can be out. However, the Rashba explained that according to Rav, you cannot depend upon the capability of finding a room for him to be out of that commitment. So therefore, he needs to grant her divorce immediately. So the disputation is, if the 30 days period, it means 30 days, or it means that he just need to appoint the stud. It's a big disputation among the early sages. So the Gemara asks, why does Rav and Shmuel need to dispute it that way? V'ha if legubei b'chad zimna. It's already a disputation that took place earlier. So I need to revisit that subject. where is it? Now we're going to juxtapose another subject of disputation that have a lot of similarity. We learned it now, we learned the Mishnah, page 61. Hamadir esh tishto mitashmish hamita. One of the three commitments, if you remember, Book of Shemot, Book of Exodus, chapter 21, the Torah said that the man, by him marrying, acquiring a wife, he commit himself to three things, right? She'era, ksuta, and onata, which means the third commitment is to provide, if for sure if he's physically capable, to provide her the means of intercourse, of normal physical relation between husband and wife. So therefore, he basically, if he's capable, by the way that the Torah said to us, he cannot prohibit himself to have relation with her. But the Mishnah said that he did it. So if he did this way, Beit Shammai Omrim Shtei Shabbatot, for example, they involved with a big fight, and he said, you know, I prohibited myself to have relation with you. But he did not specify. So as you know, in Judaism, we take every statement from every person seriously. So Beit Shammai said, you know what it means? It means for 2 weeks she can wait for him. But if it's exceeded more than 2 weeks, he needs to give her the money of the Ketubah, the marriage contract, and let her out, let separate it. She can wait 1 week, but no more. So Rav elaborates on this Mishnah. And he tells us, Machloket bim faresh, the disputation between Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel is, if someone said it unambiguously, he said it in a, such a clear, lucid way that applies to 1 week or 2 weeks, etc. Aval bistam yotzila atar, but if it was just a general statement, you know, sometimes people get mad. They said something. So if it's a general statement, yotzi le'altar, he needs to do it immediately, v'yiten ketuba, he needs to pay for the marriage, the money that he commit himself at the marriage contract. U'shmuel amar, afilu bistam, even it wasn't a clear cut of time for his vow, name lo yotzi, is also not release, that not separated, she needs to wait either 2 or 1 week. Why? Shema yimatze petach lenidro. Maybe in the interim, he will find an opening for his vow that will enable him to be released from it. So this is basically a, if we juxtapose the two, it's a parallel disputation that we said in the Mishnah. So, since it's already said in the Mishnah, yes, over there it's money, and here we talk about the relation. But the disputation is equivalent, it's parallel, so why you need to dispute it here again in our Mishnah? So the Gemara said, both disputation needed. Why? Tzricha. De'i itmar behi. If you talk about that disputation, that solely applies to what? To relations. Behahi kama Rav. In that Mishnah, Rav said that if someone prohibited without going to all the specific, mishum delo efshar befarnas, because he cannot use a different steward. Aval beha, if someone prohibited his wife from the basic sustenance, the efshar beparnas, that they can use a steward. Eima modele leShmuel. So you may say that Rav agree with Shmuel that even someone just general, bestam, general expresses himself, you go by the period of up to 30 days and having appointee, steward appointee, maybe it may happen that there is some petach, some opening to release him from his vow, and therefore we need to teach us that Rav disputed Shmuel even in regards to this Mishnah. Ve'i itmar beha, if that disputation applied solely in our Mishnah, we may mistakenly say beha kamar Shmuel, over there Shmuel said that we should wait mishum de'efshar beparnas, because it is a possibility to use what? A steward. Aval be'ahi, over there the other Mishnah in Tractate Nedarim that speaks about a man that prohibited his wife from the manner of cohabitation between husband and wife. Since the husband cannot use a steward, because that's a physical commitment between him and her, unlike mezonot that can be used a monetary support by third party, therefore a man model le Rav, you may think that he agree with Rav that if he just make a general statement, he needs to divorce her immediately, and therefore we need to teach us that Shmuel disputed the Rav even in that regard, and therefore we need to learn both sections, both Mishnayot. One speaks about the money, which is using a third party, the steward, to distribute the money at that period of time, versus the other that is different because it is a physical commitment and cannot be used by third parties. So therefore, even the disputation is equivalent, but we need to learn it in the two different sections in the Talmud. So the Rishonim ask a question. Why, according to Rav, he prohibited his wife to derive benefit from his mezonot, from his wealth, and we wait a third month period, maybe he is abrogated, he is mefer neder. So Rabbeinu Nissim, the Ran, and others explained to us that what's the deepest idea, which is very deep psychological understanding, see the wisdom of the rabbis. They said, when a husband said a date, a time, so you have a time restriction and you have a framework and you know where you're coming from and when you go. But if he's not specified and she's living in a limbo and is no specific time and she carry a huge pain by being in a state of punishment and in a pain, in a state of unknown, no matter for our discussion if she's guilty or not guilty, he is right, she is right, we don't go there. It's just she have in her mind now, this man hates me. And since she feel, the Ran said, in that way, she basically can no longer maintain a future relationship with him, as much as you can go to a healing process. And therefore we, meaning the rabbis, can interfere for the sake of good and welfare of the structure of that family, and call upon him to go ahead and give her the ketubah and release and break up the relationship. Now we challenge from our Mishnah on the view of Shmuel. Hamadir et ishto shelo tit'om echad mikol haperot. Here you have a situation that the husband, he said to his wife, I don't want you to taste a specific fruit. Let's say guava. Mm-hmm. It carry a special smell. The man like me, all right, I like it a lot, okay? 30 years ago, it was a warning sign. You want to eat it outside of our apartment, right? Which is okay for me. But here, if the husband said to his wife, I prohibited you from eating certain fruit, Yotzi v'iten ketuba, he must divorce her and give her the ketuba. So it means you have to do it, Rashi said, immediately. So why? Because the Mishnah did not specify a period of time. Bishlama le'rav. If you go by the Rav, who tells us at the first clause of the Mishnah, that if he prohibited her from mezonot, from the financial support, you have to wait for what? For 30 days period. And the last clause, we're speaking about him prohibited her from certain produce. You do not need to wait. Kan bistam, kan bimfaresh. You have to differentiate between saying in general or saying specifically. There is a book called Or Sameach. He explained to us in Ilchot Ishut, chapter 13, that a person cannot prohibit his wife from eating certain fruits. Why? Because it's how far you say that she is his, like Tosfot tells us. You can say it, for example, let's say the person said, you cannot derive benefit from my estate if you eating this fruit. So the Ran said, that's an effect, he can say it, right? But there are some situations that he can exercise this right, which means he can say, if that will happen, remember that story, he said to her, you don't go with this man that you used to date before we got married. I don't want you to speak to him, I don't want you to have anything to do with him. Right? Gilbert?
Yeah.
You know cases like that? And then all of a sudden, he caught her talking to him. Right? So here we talk about fruits. He said to her, I can't stand this smell, I can't this taste it. If you're doing that, I'm not going to give you anything for my money. Right? So they said,
smoking.
What?
Smoking cigarettes.
Smoking cigarettes, beautiful. But here, look, smoking cigarettes, you can argue that it's very unhealthy.
Well, I understand, yeah.
But here, fruits, it's not fruits, yeah. It's healthy, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe it's a food that is not good for her. But anyway, it's healthy. Anyway, so Rav said, if he's not put a clear cut of time, so you need to divorce her immediately. Ela leShmuel. That he said, if it was general statement, you need to wait a period of time, kashya. What's the difference between reisha and a sefer, between the first clause and last clause? So why, if he prohibited her a specific produce, he needs to divorce her immediately? So the Gemara said, hacha b'maya skinan. The last clause of the Mishnah, you know what they're speaking about? Kegon, that it's not a case that the husband make the vow. Here, do you remember the introduction? The Vilna Gaon tells us that the moment that the husband kiyem haneder, the moment the husband display equanimity, he will acquiesce. So lo nitan lehatir, you cannot release it. Meaning, if the day passed, he was there, he acquiesced, he agreed, right? And it's over. Now all of a sudden, the next week, he wake up or whatever, and he said, you said there. So therefore, you do not wait for 30 days because she come after her husband, she wants to get divorced because of that vow. Since she demand divorce, so for sure you not release the vow during that time. Versus the first part, the reisha, that the husband is the one who prohibited her from the financial support. We're waiting 30 days period because there is some room that he may find a petach, find a way to be out of that vow. Vekasava Rabbi Meir, and Rabbi Meir hold, who noted etzba ben shinah. This is using a euphemism which we use several times. It means that even the husband is the one who prohibited his wife, but it's like putting her finger between her teeth to be beaten, meaning that even she is the one who makes the vow, but she can demand divorce with Ketubah, because the moment he was acquiesced, he was quiet, so it's like you let your wife to put the finger between the teeth and get beaten. So you can't tell me that she is the one who bite herself, but he is the one who causes. Tosfot Reed said that she basically come to us and said, look, he was there, right? And she said, I did it because I was so sure that he is going to abrogate it, he's going to annul what I said. If I knew he's not going to do it, I'll never vow. Did you ever heard a divorced woman said to you, I'll go back to him in a second. If he called me, if he said he's sorry and he wants me back, but he never did it. Did you ever hear that? I heard that. So here she come to us, Lehavdil, and she said, that's the Tosfot Reed. She said, I made it, but I was so sure he's going to right away annul it. But he certainly was quiet. So now I want to get divorced. Right? So So the Gemara challenged that and said, "V'savar Rabbi Meir, who noten etzva ben shineh v'atanya, ha'isha shel adra ben nazir, the woman, the wife, she commit herself to be a nazirite, v'shama ba'ala ve'lo efer la, nazirite is prohibited to involve with alcohol, to drinking wine, to shave hair, cannot contaminate it to dead people, So that's called inui nefesh, which like, in a way, the language of the Torah is the suffering of the soul. So the husband can annul that. Why? Because avoiding yourself from drinking, it's considering something that causes soul, the same as contaminating with the dead body. The Gemara in Tractate in Darim, page 83, said that this is one of the things that cause a great sorrow with internal part of a person. So the husband was there, v'shama ba'ala ve'lo efer la. And the husband was there and is not annul her vow. Rabbi Meir ve'Rabbi Yehuda omrim, hina nais b'ben shineha. She caused it to herself. Ulefichach, im ratza ba'a le'afer yafer. Which means that it's just continuation of what we said. Ve'im amar efshi b'ishan adranit. I don't want to stay with a woman that makes such a vow, good morning, and he wants to divorce her. So therefore, tetze shelo b'ketuba. So then she caused the divorce. So then she go out without the ketuba. Rabbi Yosef ben Elazar omrim, hu noten etzba ben shineha, lefichach im ratza ba'a le'afer yafer. Ve'im lo, amar efshi b'ishan adranit, yotzi v'yiten ketuba. So you see here, according to Rabbi Meir, she is the one who basically initiated the divorce. So the Gemara responded and said, Eipuch, you have to see the Braita the other way around. Rabbi Meir v'Rabbi Yehuda omrim, hu noten, v'Rabbi Yosef v'Elazar omrim, hi natna. So it means Rabbi Meir hold that the husband is the one who caused it, and he basically matched what we said in the Mishnah. So the Gemara asked, V'savar Rabbi Yossi hi natna, but Rabbi Yossi hold that she put her finger between the teeth, which again it's euphemism. V'atnan we learn in the Mishnah that if someone pronounces a vow on his wife that she should not adore herself with a certain item, so he must divorce her and give her the ketubah, give her the money that he commit himself in the ketubah. Rabbi Yossi omer ba'aniyot shelo natan kitzva. If you talk about those poor women, that it wasn't a limit for the duration of the vow, so that's one versus a rich is a 30 days. So it means that the wife make a commitment and the husband go along with it. And Rabbi Yossi said that anyway he needs to divorce her, which means since he's not abrogated her vow, it's like someone who put between the teeth. Eima Rabbi Meir Rabbi Yossi omrim hu noten, Rabbi Yehuda Rabbi Elazar omrim hi natna. Vesaba Rabbi Yehuda hi natna. Ve'atnan Rabbi Yehuda omer b'Yisrael yom echad yekayem. So it means that she make the vow and the husband agree with her. So anyway, Rabbi Yudah hold that the husband release her with the ketubah, which means that he hold that since he is not annul or abrogated her vow, is the same as someone who's put the finger in the teeth. אם הרב מאיר ורבי יהודה ורבי יוסי אומרים הוא נותן ורבי אליעזר אומר היא נתנה ואם תמצא לומר זוגי זוגי קטני which means this is a pair of תנאים אם הרב מאיר ורבי אליעזר אומרים היא נתנה ורבי יהודה ורבי יוסי אומרים הוא נותן הסתמה דלא כרב מאיר so it means that this is not according to רב מאיר the husband is not doesn't have to divorce her and it's like she caused it so it means according to Shmuel it means that what the Mishnah tried to tell us is regardless if the vow is applies to someone who asks her not to taste certain produce or someone who said that she should not adore herself a certain way and she make that vow and her husband go along with that וסבר רבי יוסי בעניות שלא נתן קצבה רבי יוסי maintained that this thing speak about poor woman that he must divorce his wife if he did not give a certain time limit for the duration of the vow על מה בעל מצא מפר ורמינו אלו דברים שהבעל מפר דברים שיש במינוי נפש אם הרחץ אם לא הרחץ אם התקשט אם לא התקשט so all of that it's in the nefesh it's cause of sorrow that the husband can annul it אמר רבי יוסי, אין אלו נדרי עינוי נפש. רבי יוסי said, they are not vow of self-denial, so the husband cannot do it, ואלו אין נדרי עינוי נפש, לא אוכל בשר. For example, she said, I'll not eat meat, I'll not eat, ושלא ישתה יין, I'll not drink wine, ושלא יתקשט, I'll not adore myself. 71b, בבגדי צבעונים, which means the Rashi explained that not using certain colorful garments is like some type of humiliation because the husband in a way he's not get attracted she's not attracted to him if she's not wearing them so therefore it's considering a sorrow So it's not the same as using a certain adornment, cosmetic, etc., etc., like she put a makeup or she put all kind of perfumes. That's not considering a inui nefesh as sour. So it means that according to Rabbi Yossi, a husband cannot abrogate the vow if she commit herself, I'm not going to use a makeup. Or I'm not going to use certain perfumes, so the husband cannot abrogate that. So they said, "Hacha b'maya skinan." What the Mishnah speak about the dvarim shebeino leveina. For example, she commit herself with things that relate to intimate relation between him and her, and the Gemara Nedarim 79 go to the specifics. So even this is not just one of those adornments. The husband here you have to differentiate when the husband can do it, can annul it or not. So Anicha leman d'amar, this is clear דברים שבינו לבינה הבעל מפר. אלא מה דאמר אין הבעל מפר. So מה יקרא למימר דאיתמר דברים שבינו לבינה. רבונה אמר הבעל מפר. אבל ברב אמר אין הבעל מפר. שלא מצינו שועל שמת באפר פיר. So here in my book on Rashi, we're running out of time, but Rashi said here, חור שהוא גדול שם, כלומר דבר שהוא רגיל בקיר להישמר שאינו מזיקו. So here Rashi wants to explain, it's using the fox is an allegory, that here, based on Shita Mekubetzet and other, it's the issue of how that affected the relationship between them. So it's the same. The Rashi tried to say that using the mashal, the allegory of a fox, is an example that since the fox gets used to something and it's not damaged here, So therefore the husband cannot have that claim. So according to that, or according to Avada Barava, here is the question, because according to, if you follow the way of Rabbi Yossi said in the Mishnah, the husband can abrogate his wife from some vow that involved with beauty. So it means again that we see it in a broader picture, that the dislikeness between her and him in such a level that she basically wants to find a reason not to have a relation with her husband. כדאמר רב כהנא, דאמר רב כהנא, הנאת השמישי עליך כופה ומשמשתו. So here he hold that you cannot compare someone who prohibited the produce to some. But here, since she is basically in a relationship, she committed herself to be with him, so therefore she cannot say, I don't want to, for sure we not talk about period time, we don't talk about sickness, we don't talk about situation like that, just she doesn't want, he cannot, you know, rape her, God forbid, but she cannot, הנאת השמישך עליי יפר, לפי שאין מכנים דבר אסור לו. So here, you have to differentiate when the vow take an effect, and you need to have an annulment or not. So he said, ולא תתקשר ולא תעשה, אם כן, קרו לה מנובלת. So maybe if she's avoiding herself from all the beauty, she's not having the cosmetics, she doesn't have the makeup, she doesn't have the perfume, she doesn't have all of that. And so that's a matter that the husband can annul it. So they said, ותתקשר ותעשר, אילה בית שמאי שתי שבתות, לבית שבת אחת, as we said earlier, we differentiate between בית שמאי דוצא, that is a 2 weeks period. That according to בית שמאי, if it's a person prohibits himself from cohabitation of his wife, so he can wait for a period of 2 weeks. As we said in page 61, and Beitil, it's 1 week. So how come when it's come to neder of kishut, neder vow of beauty, that we differentiate that to, from that to the others? So the Gemara said, Hanemi leyahecha de'adra ihu. When the husband is the one who initiated that. The savra mirtach ratach ilaviv ashta motiv da'atei. At the time that he made this vow, he was mad at me. So people usually make this vow when they are in a state of anger. But now, when everything comes down, so she can wait a week or two until he comes down. And then he may find a room, an opening to annul his vow. Havalacha, when it's come to a cosmetic, to a beauty, right, to adornments, then adra ihi veshatikla. Remember what we said in the introduction, that if she is the one who makes the vow, and he was acquiesced, and it's not because he was angry, but he heard the vow and he kept quiet. Savra medishtik misna udesanili. As we explained around, if he displayed equanimity, if he was quiet, you know what does that mean? That the man really hates me, because I expected him, when I made that vow, to go right away and said, you are nuts, it's not going to happen, I abrogated it. But he sat quietly and did not say anything. So it means that he hates me and he doesn't want to be with me anymore. So therefore, the sages cannot ask her to wait even until the time she looked nicer and adore herself and beautified herself, etc. But they ask to divorce immediately. So basically here you see the final stage of that disputation between Rav and Shmuel in the interpretation of the Mishnah. And basically what we said is, number one, we have someone who prohibits his wife from deriving benefit from him. So it's applied to all the support. The second one, if it's a certain produce, he doesn't want her to use. For example, as we said, he doesn't like the smell, he doesn't want the guava, and he said, if you use it, I'm not going to let you use any of my money, etc., etc. So again, we ask him to divorce, or he asks her not to use a certain perfume. So again, we ask him to cut the relation. The big question we keep asking is if it's any hope or if it's any room for annulment. Rabbi Yossi Omer, ba'aniyut shalom tan kitzva, if it's a poverty stricken, that it's not a measure of time, but if he put a time, so he's not released, but you need to wait. Bechama kitzva, how long? Again, Rashi here said, כלומר, אם נתן קצבה, עד כמה לא קייפינה להוציא? How far? And שיטה מקובץ to explain that we have to differentiate between saying a bound of time or not. אמר רבי אמר שמול 12 חודש, until that period of time she can be without the adornment. רבי ברכה אמר, רבי יוחן 10 שנים, 10 years, רבי חיסדה אמר, אבי מרגל, as we said, the festival, the three festivals, the one who is closest by. Why, like we are now between Pesach and Shavuot, is until Shavuot. Shekhen lo b'sel mitkashot b'regel. The manner is that people beautify themselves for the holiday. So the last part of the Mishnah, Rabbi Yossi said, ובעשירות 30 יום, and the rich woman, the 30 days. מה ישנה 30 יום, why 30 days? אמר רבי יש, כאן אישה חשובה, נהנית מרחק כשוטיה, 30 יום. So basically, she reused her adornment, her beautification for 30 days. Poor one can exceed it more, because she cannot afford to have a dormant constantly. The reach, it's up to 30 days. You have to remember that we have the framework of context of time and those days, for sure, as far as they using a perfume and a dormant was somehow different than nowadays. But anyway, here we continue with different type of vow that the husband prohibiting himself from his wife, that he needs to divorce her as a result of that statement. המדיר את אשתו שלא ילך בדבר בזמן שהוא. Oh, that's so common. So the husband said to his wife, I can't stand your family, I don't want you to go there, right? You're smiling, right? But that's the reality. I don't want you to go to the parents. Ima ba'ir. They live in the same city. As you know, one of the mistakes usually is if the parents and children live in the same city, you know, the in-laws issues. חודש אחד יקיים, if it's 1 month, he doesn't need to divorce her. However, שניים, if it's more than 1 month, which means the ritva said at the beginning of the second month, which means that the vow period exceeded more than 1 month, so they said, יוצי, he needs to divorce her. So he said, ויתן כתובה, he needs to pay the marriage contract. ובזמן שהוא בעיר אחרת, if they live in a different city, which means it's not all the times, the daughter go to her father, mother, to her parents, during the three festivals. רגל אחד יקיים, because she can survive 1 month without going to her parents. שלושה יוציא ויתן כתובה, but if it's three festivals, which basically is about a year period, she cannot live like that, that she cannot go to her parents for 1 year. Remember, that was before the era of telephone, right? Or email, right? He just said, don't go there. Okay, another one. המדיר את אשתו שלא תלך לבית האבל. He doesn't like someone. So he said to her, I don't want you to go there and comfort the mourners. I don't want to go there. או לבית המשתה. If the couple get married, the bride and the groom, I don't want you to go to that wedding, right? יוציא ויתן כתובה. So he basically needs to give her the money to commit himself in the Ketubah and let them divorce. Why? Mipnei she'noel befaneha is like locking the door for her, right? He put her in such a situation, making a bride and a groom happy or comfort the mourners, right? So that's exceeded. Ve'im haya tohen mishum davar acher. Rashai, but if his claim is because in that place people get drunk, right? They're drinking a lot, and I know what's going to happen or may happen. So therefore, that's the reason, because I know you're going to drink with them and you get drunk and who knows how it ends up. So then you have the right to that claim. Amar la, al mat shetomri leploni ma shamart li, o al mat shamarti lach, o shetem ala o meara la ashpa, יוציא ויתן כתובה. The Gemara later explained what exactly involved in those stipulation of in statement. So the Gemara now first dealing with the first clause of the Mishnah, that someone said to his wife, don't go to your parents' house. הגוף הקשיא, אמרת רגל אחד יקיים. Later you said at one festival, she can abide by that. השניים, יוציא ויתן כתובה. If it was more than festival, if it's two, he needs to divorce her. Hey, Masefa, you go, explain to me the last part of the Mishnah, Shlosha, Yotzivit, and Ketubah. If there's the three festivals, he should give her the get, Hashnaim, if it's two, Yekayem. So it means that the beginning we said that the two festivals, he should divorce her. So Amar Abaye, Seifa, Atan Lekoenet, the last clause speaking about the wife of Kohen. So it means Rabbi Yehuda said that since the Kohen prohibited to marry a divorcee and he cannot return his wife if he divorced her, so therefore the sages give more time because there is maybe a chance to find a room to annul his vow, which means the first part of the statement speaks about regular non-Kohen's wife, that you wait only one festival, but the other two festivals you need to divorce, and the last part of the Mishnah, the Seifa, speaking about the wife of Kohen, that even in two festivals you need to fulfill the vow, and only three you need to divorce her. Rabba bar ula amar lo kasha kan berdufa kan b'shena redufa, which is, he differentiated between, that's what Rashi and others said, that she is very enthused, very much, to go to her parents' house. So you wait only 1 month. You know, there are some that are very, very connected to their parents. The other one, it's not. So you have two. So now, by the way, since we use the term redufa, which means someone who's very enthusiastic, he or she is very enthusiastic to go to her parents' house. So we bring an agadic expression of Rabbi Yochanan. We said in a Song of Songs, chapter 8, verse 10, the Song of Songs, as we all know, it's the deep love between Hashem and the nation, our nation, and it's used the allegorical term like a deep love between man and woman, the husband and wife. So they said, "As hayiti ve'einav kemotzesh shalom." Then I'll be in his eyes as someone who received or acquired peace. Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Rabbi Yochanan explained that this is an allegory, kechala shenimtzet shlema bebeit chamiya, which means it's like a bride that she sounds, looks perfect in the house of her husband, which means there have the minag at the first stage after they get married to live by his parents' house. Urdufa lelech ulagit shivcha bebeit aviyah. She can't wait to go to her parents and to tell them how great is her husband, how beautifully he treated her, how she is happy with him, etc., etc. So the Midrash said, all the nation of the world will say to us, if you tell us, and you hear it sometimes, that God loves you Jews, so how come he exiled you, and how come he allowed to have your temple destroyed, and how come God allowed the crisis of World War II, and how come, Dr. Friedman, are you listening? Very nice. Okay, so we answer, and we said, we are like the daughter of the king, that she went to have to visit their father during the festival, which means that all this exile is temporarily. The same way as the bride, newly married, she go to the parents' house for the festival, and then she returned to the house of her husband. So they said, the prophet Hosea said in chapter 2, verse 18, "Vaya bayom ahu," in that day, it's a prophecy of the salvation, "Ne'um Hashem," the word of the Lord, "tikrei ishi v'lo tikrei li od ba'ali." You express yourself in the highest level of love, not my husband, but even more deeper love. Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Almighty said that that's the relationship between the nation, the time of their redemption, the time of salvation, kechala bebet chamiya v'lo kechala bebet aviyah, which means that like one who married and she is in a husband's house, and she gets used to her husband, she's not embarrassing with him, she feels, or she said, like they have a deep love, like they used to have during the childhood years, and not like one is in a father's house, because chalab beit aviyah, the father is like the master, the father, she have a fear, She abides by the father because she's afraid that he's going to be mad or punish her. It's a two different relationship. So the Ish Bitzer Rebbe, he explained that it's like little child. The father said, don't do this, don't do that. So when the child grew up, he always said, during his teenager, oh, wait. When I grow up and I'll be mature, I'll do whatever I want. Then he grew up, and then he realized how right his father, right? So then all of a sudden, he get deeper love to his father because he understand that the father admonish him, it's out of love. It's a famous story about Yismach Moshe, the great Rebbe, that he met my grandfather, was Rabbi Herschel Zidichoy. So he said to him, you know, we suffer so much Jewish blood split over the war, over the Holocaust, over so many crises. He says, we do not understand now why the Jewish people need to go to all these crises. But the same way as Mitzrayim and the Galut in the exile in Egypt, we went to that and we came out with the Torah and the Promised Land. The same way we believe that at the end of the days, everything turned around and we fully understand why we need to go to such a period of suffering. And the time comes that Hashem will help us to build the third Beit HaMikdash and bring the Mashiach, and at that time we fully understand the Jewish suffering, we fully understand. It's like, in that sense, husband and wife, that she is, can't wait to relationship with the husband versus the relationship with the fear of the father. It's two different categories. One is a relationship out of fear, and one is a relationship out of deep love.
Shuloim, Malachai, Shuloim, Malachai.